presented by ICICI Lombard General Insurance.
Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable. ICICI Lombard and CNBC TV 18 present the India Risk Management Awards.
Globalization, technology disruption, an act of God are given. But today, CEOs seem to face newer and newer kind of risk. Casteism, nationalism, trade protectionism, and geopolitical uncertainty. Given this kind of situation, is doing business tough? Let me ask the man who understands risk and underwrites the risk for his views. Joining me in the show is Mr. Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO of ICICI Lombard. Bhargav, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ravi.
Bhargav, if I may begin by asking you, traditionally risk management meant financial risk, but now it seems to have gone beyond financials. Today, one feels company will need multiple risk managers attending to specific risk. Is this feasible, number one? And how do you develop a futuristic vision of risk management?
We don't believe that risk management was ever only a financial risk matter. So if you look at, let's say from our perspective, we've had an enterprise risk management framework in ICICI Lombard for almost 10 years now. Over these 10 years, we've been looking at roughly about 30 key risks in our business. But the moot point that you're making is a valid point in the sense that corporates in the past were probably not looking at risk management in a holistic manner.
Holistic manner, yeah.
Most people that we used to speak to those days wouldn't even have an ERM framework. But that's changing. I think, you know, what is happening because of the global uncertainties that you see, business, as you rightly said, you know, at the beginning, is getting more complex, more difficult, new risks are emerging. So there is a lot more heightened level of sensitivity and awareness towards risk management. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, one in our mind, a very positive development. Coming back to your second question on, you know, who is it that, you know, looks at some of these things and how do you look at a futuristic vision of risk management? I think an ERM framework is not a framework which is a responsibility of the CRO or the risk management team only.
Okay.
It is a responsibility of the collective organization. And I've always believed that the responsibility for risk starts at the top of the organization. The CEO has to be the CRO as well. So risk management has to be looked at as a collective of the organization. Correct. There has to be a risk philosophy, a risk strategy, culture that you build for the people.
So it's not pinpoint to one man.
It's not definitely a department or one man's responsibility. It's an organization's responsibility. Coming to your last point on how do you look at it in a futuristic manner, I think that's more complex and it's probably difficult to answer that question with any level of certainty. All what we try to do is keep trying to be abreast of emerging risks that we see, developing. One of the things that we see as a big change going ahead is the entire cyber physical world. Everything is getting digitized in some way or form. Yeah. Risks that are emerging from that are completely new and unknown to all of us. And we have to prepare for that. Yeah, absolutely.
Now you talk about that you have identified some 33 risks in your organization. But a 2017 study by Fickey Pinkerton has identified 12 risks that pose significant threat to business. Now let me read out what they have said. Topping that list is information cybersecurity, that is number one. At number two is terrorism insurgency. It was fourth in 2016. At number three is corruption, bribery and corporate fraud. And at number four is natural hazard, that is flooding, what we saw in Chennai. So what I want to ask you, are you surprised by this pecking order? Has some risks like strikes, closure and unrest has moved to the seventh position of risks last year? Crime has dropped to eighth position. It was third ranking last year.
So, you know, I've always believed that we human beings get more influenced by recency of events rather than what is really more important. Having said that, I'm not very surprised with the ranking because last year we've had a huge number of cyber incidents and that's probably one of the reasons why that's come up as number one right now. Having said that, I think there is genuinely a concern with how you can mitigate against, you know, cyber risks. Because if you look at, let's say, a natural hazard, that's very localized. If a flooding happens in Chennai, it affects Chennai, unfortunately, but it doesn't spread to Delhi or Mumbai, right? Yeah. That's not true for cyber, right? So, you know, you can launch a WannaCry, ransomware from any remote part of the world. And you just wake up in the morning, come to your office, you open your machine, and you see a ransomware,
That happened May 2017,
right? So something like that is fundamentally different from the types of risks that we've seen. Risks have been localized. Cyber risks can be global in a very, very interconnected world.
Yeah.
And that's something that I think as a society, not just we as a company or India as a country, as a society, as a human society, we need to think about, creating mitigating solutions for that.
So are we paying price for digitization? Because everything is moved to the digital platform. The world is moved to digital platform. All the services are offered on internet and mobile. So hackers are having a field day. You talk about WannaCry, but Uber, we saw the data breach, and there's a class action suit filed against it. And Clozo, we saw Aadhaar breach. So how do you fight this?
I think what is important for us is to think about how do we look at the new reality in what we call the cyber-physical world. Let's say Internet of Things, connected devices. We are talking about by 2020, maybe 20 million, 1 trillion such connected devices across smart homes, smart cities, servers and everything else. And how do we prepare for that reality? And how do we build mitigating solutions for this new world that we are emerging into? And that I don't think we've collectively thought enough as a society to find solutions to.
Looking at the changing scenario, as an insurer, are you also changing your business focus and the way you're going about insuring risk?
Very much so. Ravi,
what honestly, you would have done 10 years back is different today?
Very, very true. And I think the technology that we spoke about, which creates its own set of risks, is actually helping us mitigate risks as well. So one of the things that we first started 3 years back with one of the companies was we found in a particular route, a lot of hijacks happening.
Okay.
And, today telematics, we talk about telematics for retail customers, for private car. We started telematics about 3.5 years back for the corporate, one corporate, to track their logistic movement. And we were able to reduce hijacking for that corporate in that leg. So these are solutions that today is possible because you can track these. Technology makes it possible. And as an insurance company, we believe you have to move to becoming a partner to mitigate and reduce risk for our corporates rather than just become a risk transfer partner.
So, adjacent question to that is, are people still fully insured or still under-insuring themselves?
I think that's a long way.
It's a side question.
A long way ahead. I think, most of the large corporates are increasingly adequately insured. But most of the medium-sized companies, small enterprises are inadequately covered if they are. Okay. So there is a huge penetration gap in that. And then even for large corporations, a lot of companies don't even buy what is known as business interruption covers. So you buy for damage protection, as in, if something happens to your factory, we pay the losses in terms of the damage losses. But we don't pay for business interruption because you've lost revenue, right, when your factory is so you need to cover for that as well. A lot of people don't do that.
ICICI Lombard and CNBC TV 18 present the India Risk Management Awards.
So yeah, somebody has got a helicopter view and trench view of the insurance market. Do you see any emerging trend that you would like to share with our viewers?
From the insurance industry perspective, there are a lot of emerging risks because of the technology that we talked about. Cyber, for example, is probably going to be the fastest growing and potentially the biggest segment going ahead for the insurance industry. So that's obviously one emerging risk, which is becoming a talking point today. But I think more importantly, we see a huge risk with social media led reputation damage. Social media, again, is a very, very powerful tool, a very positive tool to get people together, right?
Yeah, we can't.
As I said, for everything, there is always the other side of the coin.
I think Twitch 7 times a day, I think.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's one aspect, but the point that I was making was...
I'm saying the power of social media.
Power of social media, absolutely. But the point I was making is you can use social media to spread fake news. You can, spoil the reputation of an organization fake news, fake news, and you can use, bots to launch a malignant attack on something, on a company. So I think there is a lot of risks that are emerging from a reputation perspective because of social media, apart from the cyber risk that we talked about. But if you ask me, I think the biggest risk that all of us face in business is digital disruption. I think all of our business, the entire value chain is potentially up for grabs by disruptors. And we have to be awake to that risk. I
mean, so how do you disrupt?
There's no insurance solution to this.
Yeah.
It's something that each one of us.
So how do you disrupt the disruptor as an issue then?
Absolutely.
So the other thing I want to draw your attention to, a strict risk management system might lose the company some current business, but will help build some long-term value. In India, when senior management fall into this quarterly pressures, how do you incorporate risk management in building sustainable business?
So, you know, it's like having a brake in a car.
Yeah.
Imagine a car without a brake. What would you do? You would drive at 15 kilometers per hour, 20 kilometers per hour. You wouldn't dare to drive it at 60.
True.
Without a brake. I think what a brake does in the car is to allow you the mental confidence. You know, it gives you the mental comfort that there is a mitigant through which I can, you know, stop the vehicle when I want to. I think a good risk management culture in an organization is equally positive. And at least what we found, in fact, we've been doing this award collectively for the last 3 years. We found companies which are risk leaders in this survey that we've been doing over the last 3 years are in these 3 years have outperformed the index. It's probably a myth to think that risk management reduces your, your immediate business opportunity in the short term, because 3 years is not a long term, duration in that sense. Even for 3 years, we are seeing this benefit. So we believe that a good risk management culture in an organization is extremely value creative.
So the flip question to that is, so how do you protect a company if the CEO is very ambitious and he wants to grow the top line? So he goes for M&A, he goes for acquisition. If he fails, he quits the company, but the company has to bear huge losses.
Yeah.
So that is a thinking that the senior management compensation should be linked to EVA.
Yeah.
How do you react to that?
I think the bigger question to me is, if you see the example in the West, it's a question is how are you creating the value? Is it through very, very short term measures or, you know, let's say equity buybacks or, you know, an M&A, or are you really building a, you know, business which is value creating over the long period of time?
Yeah.
And that's something I guess both the shareholders and the board members have to be very vigilant. There is no other way, but for these two stakeholders to control that.
See, in the past, the company's approach to risk management was to meet the compliance requirement. But when I look at the West, now it has moved center stage. The CRO is at the strategy table and is proactive there. Are you seeing a similar kind of trend in India?
In certain pockets, I think if you had asked me this question 3 years back, I would say that very rarely. I think the trend line is positive. We are seeing a much larger role that CROs are playing. There is a much heightened awareness of risk, as I said earlier. While CRO plays, of course, a very, very important role, as I said at the beginning, I think the responsibility for the risk lies with the CEO. If a CEO is not sensitive to risk, a CRO can't do much. So the responsibility.
But there's a general tendency to blame the CRO.